So everyone, this is Caleb Bartholomew. Say hi, Caleb. All right, he says hi back. I know he's got a lot of family here today. We're delighted to have you guys. We would love to get to know you. We'd love to worship alongside you anytime. We're glad to take video and pictures and things. This is a momentously wonderful occasion. Caleb and I had a talk on Wednesday about this very thing. I know Brother Scott led him to the Lord back in April. And, you know, as much as we celebrate our date of birth, the new birth in Christ, that's where it's at. That is the birth. That is the birth that truly matters. And so we're delighted that Caleb has chosen to follow Christ all the days of his life. And I do want to ask, if you're related, blood related to Caleb, or if you just want to stand up with Caleb and love on him and honor him, if you're his family, if you would stand up with us this morning. We thank you so very much for, we thank y'all for sharing Caleb with us. He's a fun kiddo, and I know Scott enjoys having him. He is a delight. He's a lot of fun to hang out with and get to know. But we thank you so much for sharing him with us, and we thank y'all for joining us today. You may be seated if you'd like. But at this time, Caleb's like, hurry up, Daryl, I'm nervous. Get me through this. Let's go. But at this time, Caleb, I want to ask you a very amazingly awesome question. I know you got a great answer for me. Is Jesus Christ your Savior and Lord?
Yes, sir.
Amen, amen. Well, it is my privilege now, my brother, to baptize you now in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried with him in the likeness of his death, and raised to walk a new life in Christ. Good. Let's pray this morning. Most gracious Heavenly Father, God, I thank you so very much for Caleb. I thank you for his family. And God, I thank you that he is part of my family because he's part of your family. Lord, I pray that you would help me, help all the other men, the women, the parents, come alongside him and encourage him in your ways, Jesus. Help him to be an encouragement to others. Lord, I think baptism, I would consider your first sermon. Like he is stepping out in faith and showing the world that, yes, I am a believer in you, Jesus. And so I pray that he would shout that from the rooftops all the days of his life and help us as the church to encourage him all along the way, Lord. We love you. We thank you. And it's in Jesus' holy, precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.
And sings my soul. Yeah.
sing that again. Our faith will rise.
Faith will rise as we wait upon the Lord.
Get to sit beside all the musicians and hear all the music firsthand. Dear Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for your many blessings. So we thank you that we do have some good musicians to help us and lead in the worship. We thank you for this congregation to brave the weather to come see you today, and we thank you for the soul that was added to your kingdom. We praise your holy blessings, and we ask that you be with Brother Darrell as he leads us in our worship. We thank you for your blessings and love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. All right, please be seated. Let's continue to sing.
I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure, and his joy is gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, his joy comes in the morning. Trading, I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame. Amen. Well, I'm pressed but not
That's what he does. He takes all of our bad stuff. He gives us good stuff. He gives us joy and he gives us hope.
Twas a life filled with aimless desperation. Without hope, walked the shell of a man. Then a hand with nail print stretched downward, and just one touch, then a new life began. And the bells burned with lightness and anger, and little feet ran in terror to hide. Now those walls ring with love, warmth, and laughter, since the giver of life moved inside. And the old rugged cross made the difference in a life bound for heartache and defeat. And I will praise him forever and ever, for the cross made the difference for me. There's a room filled with sad, ashen faces, and without hope, death had wrapped them in gloom. But at the sight of the saint, there's rejoicing, and the life can't be sealed in a tomb. And the old rugged cross made the difference in a life bound for heartache and defeat. And I will praise him forever and ever, for the cross made the difference for me.
Let's pray. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the opportunity to come to church and to sing the old songs, and sometimes the new ones. We thank you for all the gifts you've given us. We owe you everything. You've given us 100% of everything we have, so we're returning our offerings as much as 10% and sometimes more. With grateful hearts, we thank you so much, Heavenly Father, for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die an awful death on the cross that we might be saved. We thank you so much, Heavenly Father, for all the gifts you have given us. And everything that we own comes from you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Jesus, your name is power.
Jesus, your name is might. Jesus, your name will break every stronghold. Jesus, your name is might.
Jesus, your name.
Chorus once a cappella together.
Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till the work on earth is done.
But I really enjoyed that last instrument with our voices and singing a joyful noise unto the Lord. And I think so many people get nervous about singing. People can hear me. And the Bible says, make a joyful noise to the Lord. I don't care if it's not joyful to the person next to you. But it is truly joyful. I love hearing you sing. And I'm very biased, but I love seeing my wife and Lila, my oldest, up here singing with y'all. And I love having them as part of that. I had to take a picture of my little girl being up here. And so it's just very exciting to see his daughter excited to do worship. Right before I stepped up here, she's a very good artist. She had drawn this background also last week. I was like, wow, that's pretty impressive. And amen, Miss Barbara, the old rugged cross made the difference. Who can proclaim that this morning? What a wonderful, wonderful blessing. Amen. Thank you for sharing that song with us. So I want to start off with serious, serious business. Ready? Here it comes. How many of you like the restaurant Amigo Juan here in town? There's a few people. We've eaten there. We really like it too. Good place. Good place. It's good. How about Ironwood Grill? Oh, yeah. I heard some oh, yeahs right there. All I know about Ironwood Grill is it's right across the street from Amigo Juan. We've not been there yet. I hear they have a really good steak. How about the bigger chain places like, I don't know, a Texas Roadhouse? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. There it is. That's one of our favorite places. Every time we pass it, the kids, especially my boys, will yell out, Texas Roadhouse, every time we pass it, no matter what it is. They are really only in it for the bread. Let's be real. Amen to that. I was telling the baptistry committee back here, I said, this shirt used to button up all the way. It does not. I normally button all the way to the top. So I guess that we've eaten Texas Roadhouse a little too many times. But our boys, especially my son Zane, is all about the rolls. We've got a rainy man who won't eat his regular food. But who can blame them, right? So good. So now let's switch gears for a second. We'll tie these things together. You'll see where I'm going with this. Raise your hand if you are very good with directions. I mean, like driving directions. You have a good sense of direction. That's not really very many people. That's not many people. How many of you need a GPS everywhere you go? To places you've been before. That's me. Oh, if my phone is dead, I'm just messed over. Like, oh, I don't know how to get there. Like, I'll call Katie. Katie's my GPS. I run around with a little Rand McNally with me, my wife. But she always knows. So now let's combine those things. If I asked you guys to give me directions to any of those three restaurants that I mentioned, I fully believe that somebody here could give me directions. I fully believe that you could give me directions there, right? I bet somebody could even then give me an alternate route, which is, I don't know. I say route, of how to get there. You could give me an alternate route on how to get there. And then I bet there's even a third way that somebody could tell me how to get there, you know, just in case. You know, there's traffic, or there's a wreck, or there's a train, or whatever it may be, construction, just in case those other spots are blocked. But the longer that you live in a place and you drive its roads, what happens? The better we know the lay of the land, right? What happens is you know all the good restaurants, you know the best stores, you know the fun places to hang out. You know how to get there, and if there's a train or construction, like I said, in the way, you know how to find that alternate route to get there. To that destination. There are so many streets that run here and there and to and fro, you can always find the detours to reach your destination, right? There's a lot of you that are really good with that. I'm really not one of those people, but you might be really, really good at that. But how many of you would not be embarrassed to admit that you have driven the wrong way on a one-way street? Ooh, that's a lot of hands. I remember doing it as a teenager, like, whoa, you realize real quick, I went the wrong way. There's a loop in a town close to where Katie and I are from in Athens, Athens, Texas, or just outside of Eustis, Texas. There's a loop, and we're going uphill, and there is a lady who's coming right at us. Oh, that is, oh, and I don't even know that she didn't veer out of the way. We did. We moved. I was like, how do you not know? Man, everybody's going a different direction. Like, I don't know how she didn't realize that, but it's a scary thing. There are really not more things that are terrifying than that. There's a lot of stuff that can scare you, but that is a very scary ordeal. But the second you see another car coming towards you, it's very clear, hey, I've made a mistake, right? It should be abundantly clear. You do whatever you can do to get off that road, to get turned around so that you're headed in the right direction. Well, honestly, it's not often easy to see when we're on the wrong road to heaven. But Jesus makes it clear, abundantly clear in his word, that he is, get this church, he is the only way. He's the only way. And if we use our Bible as our guide and we make Jesus our Savior, we make Jesus our Lord, then he will set us on the right path. He will keep us moving forward. And why, church, should we move forward? Why should we move forward, anybody? That's our goal, yeah? We serve the great I am, not the great I was. I don't have to look back at all. Sometimes we should look back to know where we came from to see, you know, I get all that. But if we're just holding on to that junk of the past, Jesus is the way, he's the truth, he's the life. Let's follow him, the great I am. Follow him where he's going. He's always moving forward. He's always pursuing us and others. But many people, they mistakenly believe that heaven is just like any other destination. I don't need to follow your road to heaven, Daryl. I don't need to follow that road to heaven because I'm on my own road. I have my own beliefs. And if I'm a good person, I'll get there just the same as you Christians. You ever heard anybody say that? I was talking to a guy, and he literally said this to me. I believe what I believe. Wow, super deep stuff, sir. I didn't say that, but I said, well, what is that? You know, I believe what I believe. So I questioned him. Well, what do you believe? Well, I believe what I believe. He just kept saying, that tells me nothing. So what I'm hearing is you don't believe in Jesus. Now, you're not on the same path. It's simply not the truth. If you think that we're on the same path no matter what, I can just do good deeds and I'll be there the same as you. It's not true. The Bible makes it clear. There is one way to heaven. And guess what? It's not you. It's not me. I love you to pieces. I do already. I really do. But I didn't come here to worship you. And you should not have come to worship me. You can hear a lot maybe from me, but the Lord has gifted me with it. I can hear a lot from you, and I pray the Lord has gifted you with it. But we're not here to worship each other. We're here to worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the way, no other way, no other way. And the Bible is crystal clear that he's it. But it's up to us as followers of Christ. It's not enough to just call ourselves Christians. That word has become such a watered down word. Let's just be honest, it has. But if we are followers, pursuers of Jesus Christ in our daily world, then church, we have to keep that road, we have to keep that pathway clear. The world, they want us to believe that there are many, many roads to heaven. You can find hundreds of teachers and religions and books and 10 ways to a better you and all that stuff offering you these answers to life, but only one leads to heaven. One. Who is it, church? Sunday school answer. Jesus. Home run, yeah, right? There it is. He is the answer. God wants us to accept Jesus as our Savior. He wants us to make the path smooth also for other people. I want you to see if you have a bulletin with us today. I have a few questions in there. We have some fill in the blanks. That's just a fun little guide. If you want to keep that, have at it. We'll also do the same tonight. I'd encourage you to come hang out with us tonight. We'd love to dive into God's word with you this evening too. But I want you to hear this. What is the greatest hindrance to the gospel? The greatest hindrance to the gospel is Christians who do not live up to the standard set by Christ. Let's just be real with ourselves. When we fail, and we often do, but when we fail to live and we fail to love like Jesus Christ lived and loved, it's as if we're just placing roadblocks on this way to heaven for other people. So I pray every day that God would help us. God, help me, help Daryl lead a life, lead my family, lead my children, my wife, in a life that pleases you, Lord. Help me to instill that in my home, but especially to a lost and dying generation. If you don't believe that this is a lost and dying generation, pick up a paper, look online, watch TV. This is a lost and dying world going square to hell, and we as Christians are sitting on our duff not telling them about Jesus. The way, the truth, and the life. It's like we're saying, we're okay with you having death. You know, Jesus, he told many parables during his ministry, forcing his listeners to really think through the stories. Got to think through these to find their meanings, the true meanings. But there were times also in God's word where he speaks directly, emphatically, so that, hey, I don't want you to miss the meaning. I'm going to tell it to you plainly today. One of the most important messages that he ever delivered was made when he made it clear that there is one path to salvation. Turn with me, if you will, to John chapter 14 this morning. We're going to check out verses 1 through 14. If you're willing and if you're able, I'd love you to stand with me as we read God's word together. For those that don't know, I typically preach from the CSB, the Christian Standard Bible. If you don't own a Bible, please take the one in front of you. We would love to give you that gift, and we'll gladly just replace it. If you take that one home, wonderful. We would love to do that. So allow us to do that if you don't mind, if you don't have one. But John 14, verses 1 through 14. And by the way, you can disagree with me if you'd like. It's okay for your own study purposes. But when we're in corporate worship together, I personally don't like to use a phone looking at my Bible. Because you know what a physical Bible doesn't do? It doesn't pop up and give me an alert. I don't get a text message when I'm looking at a physical copy. I don't see what my fantasy football team's got going on today. Any of those things, right? I play fantasy football. I love that kind of stuff. But I don't want that distraction somehow hindering how I worship. So I encourage you, if you don't own one, to have a physical copy of God's word. So anyway, John 14, here we go. Jesus says, don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If not, I would have told you. I'm going away to prepare a place for you. And if I go away and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself so that where I am, you may be also. You know the way to where I'm going. Then verse 5, Lord, Thomas said, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? Here it is, church. Catch this loud and clear. Verse 6, Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Lord, said Philip, show us the Father, and that's enough for us. And Jesus says in verse 9, have I been among you all this time and you do not know me, Philip? The one who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words I speak to you, I do not speak on my own. The Father who lives in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Otherwise, believe because of the works themselves. Verse 12, truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do. And he will do even greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. God, I am so thankful that you are the way, the truth, and the life. I'm so grateful that I can come to you one-on-one, that you can change my world that is upside down and turn it right side up for you. God, help me to pursue you every single day of my life. I pray that for my family and for my church family, Lord. I pray that we would lovingly encourage each other with your word in all times. Oh, Jesus, help us to pursue you. Make much of our time together as we pursue your word. You and your word today, Jesus. We love you and thank you. Give you all the praise and glory you so rightly deserve. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So I like to break down the verses a bit as we go. So let me do that a little bit. Right off the bat, Jesus tells the disciples, he says, don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. So instead of the disciples lending support to Jesus in the hours before his cross, Jesus is having to support them spiritually as well as emotionally. I tell you, this reveals the incredible heart of Christ, his serving love that you and I are called to as well. We are called to be servants, loving servants for Jesus in the ways that he has done it. If you will keep your spot in chapter 14, but flip back to Matthew 20. We're going to look at verses 26 through 28 this morning. Matthew 20, 26 through 28. And then we're also going to go to Philippians chapter 2 here in a second if you want to kind of get that ready. But Matthew 20, 26 through 28. I hear some of you still kind of flipping, so I'll wait. But we're talking about the servant's love, the heart of Christ serving in love. Such an amazing thing. Well, he says this, Matthew 20, 26 through 28. He says, it must not be like that among you. On the contrary, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first among you must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. You see, God exalted Jesus. He gave him the name that is above all names. But Jesus attained this greatness by humbling himself as a servant and suffering unto death to save others. That's the Christ that I serve. That's the Jesus that I serve and have come to know. Turn with me, if you will, to Philippians chapter 2. If you're not familiar with where that is, it's Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. I learned it as General Electric Power Company, growing up GEPC. I don't know why. I taught youth groups, just simple, go eat popcorn, whatever, something. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, kind of help you to know where some of that is in the New Testament. But Philippians 2, I want you to see verses 5 through 11. Here is something we are called to right off the bat. He says this, adopt the same attitude as that of Christ Jesus. Ooh, that's convicting right off the bat. Sunday mornings are difficult, aren't they? I can wake up fine Monday through Saturday, but something goes awry on Sunday mornings, doesn't it? Satan is at work. Everybody's like, yes, amen. There's just something different about Sunday mornings. You know what it is? Satan says, Christian, you don't need to do that today. You threaten Satan. You're a threat. So in those moments, you feel that tug, forget it, I'm not going to come. That is the time you absolutely need to come and be a part of what we're doing. But he says, adopt the same attitude as that of Christ Jesus, who existing in the form of God did not consider equality with God as something to be exploited. Instead, he emptied himself by assuming the form of a servant or a slave, as we saw in the previous passage, taking on the likeness of humanity. And when he had come as a man, what did he do? Verse 8, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even to death on a cross. So for this reason, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Oh, you will bow either in this life or the next, but you are going to bow in submission to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Why not submit to him now? Surrender to him now. The Son of God, it's always amazing to me. We see the Son of God having this amazing sacrificial service, yet somehow we think we don't need to do that. Where's our sacrifice? So the Savior of the world offers sacrificial service to us, but we need a different path for ourselves. Says who? Not God's word. Brother Bill, a couple of Wednesdays ago, was talking about service being, hey, we should be ready to carry a bedpan. Oh, well, Lord, I don't want to do that. Nobody says, I'm so excited to take your filled up bedpan and take care of that. But the Lord has called us to humility. Do you realize over and over and over in God's word, it is about humility, humbling ourselves. You ever been at a concert behind the 6'11" guy and you can't see, or even standing at a football game, something, and you just can't see over that person? It's super annoying, right? Well, with Christ, you know what helps us to see the best? When we're on our knees in humble submission to him. So when you can't see, forget the tippy-toeing. Get on your knees to Jesus. On your knees to him. Go back to John 14, if you will. We see in verse 2, Jesus says, and my Father says, man, there's a lot of rooms. I would have told you otherwise. And I'm going away to prepare a place for you. Some of you may know this, but in Jewish wedding custom, the father, what he would do is he would add rooms onto the house for his newly married son. So Jesus is telling him, hey, I'm not abandoning you, but I'm leaving to get your eternal home ready. I'm adding on because you guys have been added to the kingdom. I'm adding on to that. So when our time comes, we shouldn't have any fear, church. Heaven has been prepared for us. Amen. The Bible says that the angels celebrate just one of us coming home. The angels had a field day celebrating Caleb this morning. And it's such an amazing thing, wonderful testimony that now Caleb shares with us, and he can have that. There's a room, he's got his own mansion over the hilltop ready for him. Wonderful, wonderful. But Caleb, I'm going to tell you that I would tell the rest of the church, it's not enough for me to go to heaven or for you to go to heaven. Now the question becomes, who's coming with me? Who are you taking with you, Caleb? Who are you taking with you, Katie? Who are you taking with you, Daryl? Who are we taking with us? Look at verse 3. If I go away and prepare this place for you, I will come again and take you to myself so that where I am, be also. So this return of which Jesus prophesied is what you and I call the rapture. It is the time when Jesus is going to return to receive his saints and take them up to heaven. Amen. We find that in 1 Thessalonians 4. I think I put the two verses on the screen. I don't remember, honestly. But 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 16 and 17, says, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the archangel's voice, and the dead in Christ will rise first." I've heard people jokingly say, that'll be Baptists. The frozen chosen. We just sit here. All right. But we shouldn't be that way. We should celebrate every single day, not being a Baptist, but being a believer in King Jesus. But the dead in Christ, we are going to rise first, church. Next verse says this: "Then we who are still alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord." Oh, man. Man alive, I love worshiping Jesus in the here and now, but oh, I can't wait to worship him face to face, to be with him. Oh, man. The Latin word for caught up that we see here is rapturo. That's where we get that term rapture. And at the rapture, those of us who are still alive, we will join other brothers and other sisters in Christ, and we will meet him in the clouds. And church, who woke up today with a sore body? Just four people. Like, we don't want to admit how sore we really are. I'm 39 and I woke up stiff this morning. Like, we still have a bunch of kids and that come in the bed with us sometimes. They'll always get middle of the night somebody. I got an elbow or a knee in my back and one on my face, and they're just all over the place. Get out. You have your own room. Anyway, but our bodies, we have limitations here, don't we? These jacked up, messed up, broken and beaten and battered bodies, they won't have the same limitations that they do today. Not only will those busted bodies be put back together, but you and I, church, look at the clouds here. You and I will literally be able to walk on cloud nine. I'm so excited about that. With the resurrected Jesus Christ, just like he was resurrected. Oh, man. What a glorious day that will be. Amen. What a glorious day that will be. I'm excited for that. Let's look at verses 4-7. Jesus says, "You know where I'm going? You know the way where I'm going." And Thomas is like, whoa, Lord, what are you talking about? We don't know where you're going. How can we know?" Jesus tells him plainly, "I am the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. None of you or no one else will come to the Father except through me. And if you know me, then you will also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." So what does Thomas ask? We just read it. What does he ask? "Where are you going? What are you talking about?" Now, since Thomas asks it, right? But all the disciples were like, "I don't know what he's talking about." I think he asked what we would all ask. Sometimes you're just like, "Hey, Thomas, why don't you ask? I don't want to feel dumb asking." Right? But I think we all get that way. He was bold enough to at least do so. And what does Jesus say? We don't know the way. "Oh, yeah, you do, because you know me. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. I'm it." Does Jesus leave any doubt about the way to God in this passage? No. No, he does not. He makes no bones about it. But you see, Thomas had misunderstood, and I don't know about you, church, but I misunderstand all the time. Thomas here, he had misunderstood. The way that is mentioned in verse 4 is not a path. No, it's a person. And who is that? Jesus. Amen. It's Jesus. Christ is the universal point of access to God. So if you want to know the Father, then you must come to him through the Son, Jesus, his Son. So Jesus assures Thomas, "If you know me, then you know the Father." You know the Father. What we see in verse 6, we see the sixth I am statement of Jesus in this book of John. So in response to Thomas's question, Jesus declares, yes, he is the way to God. Why? Because he is the truth of God. Why? Because he is also the life of God. The exclusiveness here of Jesus as the only approach to the Father, it is emphatic here. Emphatic. He makes, there is no sugarcoating around it. I am, not I might be, I could be. No, I am the way. I'm the way. Only one way, not many ways, exists to God. There's just one. Just one. I don't care if you're 6'7" or 4.5 feet tall. The ground is level at the foot of the cross. And you and I, we all get to win the same way. Amen? Because victory in Jesus, my Savior forever, sought me and bought me with his precious blood. regardless of what our world says today, there is just one way to heaven. And that way, again, is through Jesus and Jesus alone. It's always been Jesus. It'll always be Jesus. He's it. Look at verse 8. Lord, here's Philip. Lord, show us the Father. That's enough for us. And Jesus says, I've been among you all this time, and you don't know me, Philip? The one who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father, the Father is in me? The words that I speak to you, I don't speak on my own. The Father who lives in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Otherwise, believe because of the works themselves. So at the end of verse 7, what did we see? Jesus says, from now on, you do know him. They know God because they had come to know Christ in his ministry, and soon they would know him in his death and his burial and his resurrection. And to know him is to know God. This constant emphasis on Jesus as God incarnate, the God-man, if you will, is unmistakably clear in this gospel. It's unmistakably clear in the Bible. But then I'm going to be real. Verse 12 is a struggle for me. Maybe for you too, I don't know. He says, truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and he will do even greater works than these. What? Because I'm going to the Father. That part I get. I'm going to the Father. Okay, I'm going to heaven. I'm preparing that place for you. I'm going to come back. But wait a minute, Lord. Even greater works than these. What are you talking about? This is such a wonderful verse, but how is this possible? What does he mean when he says that we will do even greater works than these? So Jesus was talking about the scope of impact here. That's what he's talking about. His travels were limited in his ministry, as were the number of people who actually heard his message, heard his voice. But in the year since, what has happened? The church, the capital C church, not an individual church, but the church, believers in Jesus. We have carried his message to billions all over the world. So what happens is the church, they would become witnesses to all of the world through the power of the indwelling and the infilling of the Holy Spirit, and would bring many to salvation because of the capital C comforter dwelling in them. Well, who is the capital C comforter? It is the Holy Spirit, right? And when do we get this Holy Spirit, Daryl? Anybody know? When you accept Jesus Christ as Lord, when you accept the way, the truth, and the life, when you accept that the way is not your way, when you accept that the truth is not your truth, and when you accept that true life happens not because of you, but because of him. That's when it happens. One of my favorite verses, Acts 1, verse 8 on the screen for us now. I love this verse, one of my favorites. But yeah, Acts 1. I put it in there, maybe I did it. Acts 1, verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Wow. So as I look at that, where is Jerusalem? Where is Judea? Where is Samaria? Where is the end of the earth? Okay, well, I'm in Texas. How am I going to reach all of that? Be my witnesses in Jerusalem. Okay. Well, I take that as be my witnesses, yes, in physical Jerusalem as well. But I take that as be my witnesses in Texarkana. Okay, how about Judea, Samaria? Okay, well, let's go a step further. Texas, be my witnesses in Texas. Let's take it a step further. The United States, yep, there it is. And then what, church? To the end of the earth. Everywhere else. There it is. It's broken down right there. So the focus in verse 12 of John 14 is on spiritual rather than physical miracles. The only way Jesus' disciples would be able to be used to do those greater works, the way you and I are going to do these greater works, is through the power of the Holy Spirit. And he could not be sent as the capital C comforter until Jesus returned to the Father. But that's hard to understand. When you've been hanging out with Jesus for 3 years during this ministry, it is very, very hard to think, well, Lord, we've been relying on you all this time. What are you talking about? There's going to be the Holy Spirit. What? What do you mean? It's very hard. I'm going to tell y'all something you should already know, having had conversations with me. I don't know everything. But it baffles me when I go into certain Sunday school classes. It hasn't happened here yet, and I pray that it doesn't. But I go into certain Sunday school classes and people shut down. Like, oh, the pastor's here. I don't want to say the wrong answer because the pastor's here. I don't have all the right answers. I have Jesus. I have an interpretation of God's word that I truly believe. We can differ on various things. I read Proverbs 27:17, iron sharpening iron. And one of the main ways that for us to iron sharpen iron is to have disagreements. I really think that's how we grow sometimes, is to have good discussions, good disagreements. But don't shut down when the know-it-all pastor comes. I don't know it all. So please don't do that. At the end of the day, I'm a person just the same as you. I struggle with sin, just like you do. My sin looks different probably than yours, but I still struggle with it. I am not perfect. I have not arrived, neither have you, and we will not until we see Jesus. But let's learn together. I can learn so much from you. I jokingly tell people my mentor should have gray hair or no hair, right? Because you have been through it. You've been through it. That should be the people I look up to. So what I'm getting at is don't shut down. Like, well, Jesus, we've been relying on you all this time. Daryl's here. No, don't do that. First off, I'm not Jesus. I'm seeking to live like him, but I'm not him. Jesus, they're like, wait a minute, this comforter. Well, you've been a real good comfort to me, Jesus. Don't run off. But he had to for us to be able to do the mission he called us to do. Let's look at 13 and 14. Sorry, 13 and 14. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. He reiterates that there. So in their hour of loss and at the departure of Jesus, he comforted them with the means that would provide them with the necessary resources. I'm going to give you the resources, he says, to accomplish the task without my immediate presence being right here with you. But I've come to depend on that, Lord. What happens? You know, at the end of a prayer, and I do this probably every prayer that I do, frankly, but to ask in Jesus' name does not mean to simply tack that on at the end of a prayer. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I do that probably every time, but it's not to ask in Jesus' name is not to just tack that on at the end of every prayer like it's some kind of formula, because it isn't. But what it truly means is, first, number one, you'll see the believer's prayer should be for his, capital H, his, the Lord's purposes and his kingdom. It should not be for selfish reasons. Let me pat myself on the back. Oh, I pray so wonderfully well. I give some King James eloquent, wonderful prayer and somehow diminish yours. By the way, we aren't to critique other people's prayers. We are called to encourage them. If they want to pray better, we can come along and assist them in those ways. The best way to really pray is read God's word and learn how to pray. Pray scripture. But the believer's prayer should be for the purposes of God and his kingdom, not for us. Number two, the believer's prayer should be on the basis of the Lord's merits. There again, that capital H, his merits, and not any of my own, my worthiness. Guess what I'm worth without Jesus? Nothing. Same as you, nothing. What can I offer you apart from Christ? Nothing. So, the believer's prayer should be on the basis of God's merits. God, I know you can. I can't. Lord, I know you're the great physician, so we ask for healing. Oh, but God, help us to be the nurses you've called us to be. Help us to be the doctors you've called us to be. Help us to pull out that scalpel at times and surgically operate where we need to when it pricks hearts. Lord, help us to do those things. But help us not to cut so deep with our mean actions. Help us to lovingly persuade others to you. Help us to encourage one another. I'm the type of guy, I'll tell you, bring your steel-toed boots to church. You're probably going to get your feet stepped on. But I'm going to say even God can go through steel-toed boots. Amen? Amen? God has worked on me this entire time. Every message that I do is nothing personal at you. If you feel attacked, it's not a personal thing. It's between you and the Lord. If you feel conviction, good, frankly. It's how you grow. The Lord has convicted me with all this. Finally, the believer's prayer should be in pursuit of whose glory? God's. Not so I can somehow get credit. Scott led Caleb to Christ. Amen. But it was for God's glory. Scott's not patting himself on the back announcing, oh, I led Caleb to Christ. Look at me. Glory to Scott in the highest. Or glory to Caleb in the highest. No. pursue God and His glory because we're not glorious people at all. He deserves the glory, not you, not me. But for many people, they would read John 14, this entire passage, but especially verse 6's direct statement of being the way, the truth, and the life. It is hard to accept for our world today because why? It's not politically correct. There's a lot of PC people out there that are going square to hell, worried about offending everybody or getting offended themselves about various things. That's not a call for Christians to just be mean. But it is a call to speak the truth and love to them. No longer should you rely on the preachers and the teachers and the worship pastors to do what you can do. Lead somebody to Christ. Tell them about Jesus. Pray with and lovingly encourage them. But this entire passage is, we're viewed as intolerant. It's a slap in the face to people who weren't raised in the church. But this is one of those passages where Jesus, He draws a line in the sand here. He makes it very clear. Hey, if you want to have eternal life, you must believe in Jesus. Here's the line right here, clear as can be. Now, some might argue, well, that's not fair. God's not being fair. If you read the Bible in its entirety and not cherry pick the verses that you like or the ones that you dislike, if you read the Bible as a whole, you see that God does everything that He could to make a way to save us. He did everything. What did you do to save you? What did you do? The only thing you did, a part of your salvation, was the sin that caused it to be necessary in the first place. That's all you contributed to your salvation. That's all I contribute to the salvation that I have in Christ. It's the sin that told me I needed to have it. So here he is. He offers every way to save us. It was through woman and man, man and woman, whatever. We brought sin into the world. Adam brought sin into the world. Eve brought sin into the world. Daryl continues sin in the world. You continue sin in the world. The rebellious attitude that we all have that makes us want to go our own way, picking and choosing from other religions, that all goes back to that first act of sin and rebellion in the garden. It all goes back to that, every bit of it. We want to be our own savior. We don't want to be dependent upon God. We want control. Uh-oh. Are there any control freaks in the room? Don't raise your hand. But I think internally we're like, yeah. I don't think so. And then certain areas come up. I'm like, yeah, I am in that way. Lord, take away my sin. Oh, that sin. I enjoy that sin. Give me that back. We want control instead of surrendering it all to Him. We want it. But the truth is, we are, check this out, church, nothing without the Creator. We're nothing. If He hadn't chosen to save us, guess what? There'd be no saving us. Don't believe the lie that you can somehow work out your salvation by yourself and earn this trip to heaven. No, you see, because sin separated us from God, and the cross of Christ is what opened the way for us to be reunited with Him. Jesus is the only way. And knowing that there is this one road to heaven, and it is Christ, it is vitally important. Please hear this. It is vitally important that we as Christians keep that pathway well marked. On the road to, here's Jesus. Here's those arrows. Jesus, here. You know, you're driving along. Jesus, this way. Jesus, this way. Keep that road well marked. We need to let people that Jesus is the road to heaven, but we also have an obligation to keep that path clear. Keep it clear. Anybody want to guess, though, what the number one roadblock on the way to salvation is? Guess what? I'll give you a hint. You can find them in any church. The people. Us. Why do I want your Jesus? You look just like I do. Ooh, you ever have anybody that really feels that way? Why do I want what you have? You look just like me. You do what I do. But at the root of these blockages, we often find a lack of spiritual hunger, don't we? We're not hungry and thirsty for God's word. Outside of the confines of the four walls here, some of you don't even read God's word. I guarantee there's somebody in this room. This is the first time you've opened a Bible this week. We can often be very lazy creatures. Let's just call it. We can make our excuses. Well, I've been busy. You've been lazy. We're lazy creatures. Check out this verse. I think I put this. Ecclesiastes 10, verse 18. Did I not put that one? Sorry. I really thought I did. Ecclesiastes 10, verse 18. God's word says, because of laziness, the roof caves in. Because of negligent hands, the house leaks. Ooh. Think of that. Because of laziness, what happens? Our roof caves in. Oh, man. What was the old saying? Idle hands are the devil's workshop. Because of negligent hands, our houses leak. Well, how about our church houses? I dare say that the reason that these pews aren't filled up is because of us and Christians like us. Yeah, well, no, Daryl, that's because they got baseball today. That's because they want to see them watch football today. That's because you and I have not told them the importance of Jesus. And then we criticize when they go play baseball. I do too. Like, dang it, you need to be in church instead of playing ball. And I can preach on blue in the face, but nothing convicts them except the Lord. Amen. So there's that way too. Maybe you do share, and they don't listen. But neglect your spiritual life, and guess what? It'll deteriorate. We're that way with our baggage as well, aren't we? Some people are still dragging this unconfessed sin with them everywhere they go. Why do you think the Israelites wandered in that wilderness for 40 years? Like, man, this is a terrible GPS system. I've been wandering for 40 years. No, it's because they're dragging that sin with them. The more weight that you drag behind you, the less likely it is that you're going to reach your destination. I dare say there are many of you today that are wondering, why am I not maturing in my walk with Christ? Why am I not experiencing spiritual growth? And it's because you're carrying around a bunch of excess baggage, that ball and chain of sin. You've not surrendered it fully to Christ. You haven't. You may think, well, I can manage my sin. Nobody says that out loud, by the way. But I think sometimes we kid ourselves thinking we can manage our sin. But I'll tell you, that sin is more powerful than you are. It's more powerful. You can't move forward while at the same time carrying this load of shame. You can't move forward carrying this load of addictions in your life. So it is time for you to repent. It is time to confess your weakness to God. He already knows it's there. Just agree with him. And then you can have freedom in Jesus Christ. The way, the truth, and the life. He's the way, truth, and the life. And yet some seek a different path and said, let's follow the lies that lead to death, that lead to destruction. Let's follow that instead. Let's follow that politician. He knows the way. You see, when Christians fail to follow the example of Christ, we put stumbling blocks in the paths of others. When we're judgmental and hateful to people. Now, I will say this. As a believer in Jesus, and if you're a believer in Jesus, the Bible calls me to righteously judge you. The Bible calls you to righteously judge me. Okay, so don't miss that. But often we judge other people. I don't see where we righteously judge a non-believer. They're not going to accept what you're throwing at them because they don't follow Christ. So when we judge others based on things that are outside of God's word, I'll say it that way. But when we're judgmental, we're hateful to people. When we spread gossip, oh, we don't do that. Yeah, okay. When we spread gossip, when we fail to reach out and help the needy, when we act holy and upright in church, look at me, I put on my game face because it's Sunday morning or Wednesday night. Whoa, I'm dressed the best ever. I got my suit on today. And then what happens? I'm all dressed up nicely and then I go get trashed at a party on the weekends. What we do is we turn people away from Jesus in those moments. Again, we look just like they do. There was a gentleman by the name of Brennan Manning. You may have heard of him. He's known for his best-selling book, The Ragamuffin Gospel. He was often very public about his faults. He went to his high school reunion and had a great testimony because he was not very good to them growing up. He went to his high school reunion And he told him, I've been promiscuous, I've been a liar, I've been envious of the gifts that other people have, I've been insufferably arrogant, I've been a people pleaser, I've been a braggart. But then he shared, by sheer undeserved grace, I have been able to abandon myself in unshaken trust to the compassion and the mercy of Jesus Christ. And at one particular event, he led the late and great Rich Mullins, singer Rich Mullins, on a three-day silent retreat. If you don't know him, he's the guy that sang the popular song, Awesome God, Our God is an Awesome God. So Rich Mullins and they had this lifelong relationship from then on, and Rich Mullins even named his group a Ragamuffin Band after their encounters here. But there's an often quoted phrase from Brennan Manning that is this: the greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips, but then walk out the door and deny him by their lifestyle. That is what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. So no, we are not perfect, but that's not an excuse for the way that we act at times. As Christians, we need to be slow to speak. Uh-oh. We need to be quick to act, quick to admit our faults when we stumble. Admit our faults when we stumble. Let me say that again. Admit your faults when you stumble. Throw that out there. We need to love everyone unconditionally. Oh, no, they have to love me back. Do they? If you're doing it the way Christ does it, that's not true. We are to love unconditionally. We need to show the world that we are different. So they don't say, eh, what's the difference? We need to show the world we're different, not because we're perfect, but because we recognize really how fallen, how sinful we really are. We're called to be humble. We're called to speak the truth in love. And we're called to never do anything to hinder someone else from believing in Jesus. After all, he is the way, the truth, and the life. And there is no other way to heaven. No one else on earth or in heaven by which we can be saved. So here's the last thing I want to leave you with. Do not miss the road of heaven, road to heaven, and do not block the road for those who are searching. Follow Christ. Let your love for him light the way. Oh, we are supposed to be a beacon of light. I've been to some very dark places in this world. I've seen it with my own eyes. We're called to be a light in those dark places. So let him light the way so that others can receive Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord. If you're a believer in Jesus, don't you want everyone else to have what you have? Then where's that person sitting next to you that you invited today? Then where's that person that you told about Jesus today? We talk a big game, don't we? But we often don't let it show in our actions. So I pray that we all, myself included, very much included, change how we behave out in this world. Let's not be like them. Let's be like Christ. If you're here today, and I don't know, maybe you don't know Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, because he's not entered your life in that way. Oh, there's all these bad things that go down in my life. I don't trust your Jesus. Well, I'm going to say, whether you trust him or not, you will bow and submit to him. Our Bible, we just read that. God's word tells us that. But I want to tell you that he offers so many wonderful things to you. Grab him. He doesn't let go. That's what's wonderful too. So grab a hold of what he offers, because it is the greatest thing imaginable. You'll make some dumb mistakes in your life. You probably already have, but following Jesus will never be one of them. So I'm going to pray over you. And for the Christians, pray that we would do God's will in all things. We've got to tell a lost and dying world that he is the way, the truth, and the life. He's it. So I want to pray over you, pray over us as we seek to do those things. Lord God, I thank you for this day. Your word is tremendous. God, I love it. I love you. God, help me to practice what I preach. I struggle, God, and I pray that you would convict me when I do, that you'd make me right, turn me around, slap me around, whatever you have to do, God. Discipline me as you see fit. Help me to encourage and love and love to others the way that you do for me, God. Lord, I pray for that person that doesn't know you as Lord, that they would not leave the same way they came in. I thank you for what you're doing. in the life of this church. I thank you for what you're going to continue to do. We put our faith and trust in that. And we put our faith and trust in you, Jesus. We love you and we thank you. And it's in Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Please stand and respond as God sees fit for you to do.